Check, check.
Ça va être...
Check.
30 seconds.
Do it.
We just have to wait for the rest of the people to come in those chairs. All right. Welcome, everyone, to the Titmouse portion of the CTN Animation Expo. What is this called? Big Studio, Little Town? Little Town, Big Studio?
Yeah, I think something like that. How can you have a small studio and be successful in a giant town of bigger studios or something?
There you have it. Thanks for coming. First, let's show a reel of the fabulous Titmouse, if we may.
Wake up, wake up. You already know who it is. Mr. Thanksgiving. Casey Grow Radio. And it's a beautiful day, America. Freak Nick is back, baby.
You already know what it is, homeboy. It's your boy, Freak Nizzle. Man, I'm getting a pot of crunk. One more game, cuz. Spreading the love like I always do. Putting on for my city. Ha ha, for my city.
Speaking of which, you're hosting the biggest rap battle the world's ever seen.
It's the battle of the trillest, cuz. First place prize is a lifetime supply. Get this, a lifetime supply of money, clothes, and guess what? Hoes. Straight up, that's what it is, man. It's fun for the whole family. Yeah.
I got something to do. Guess what?
Okay.
Yoo-hoo! You know what I do, baby, and I'm doing it. Started cocaine and Johnny Hot Dog. Guess what I just did? Cocaine! He didn't even answer. Hey, Sunshine Boy, wanna check me out? Do some of this here? Cocaine! Hey, Mr. Zoo Animal, check this out. Cocaine! Hey, little boy with the balloon, check this out. Cocaine. Don't tell nobody. Hey, Mr. Police.
Awesome.
Hey, Tommy's the voice of Roxo, by the way.
Yeah, I'm the voice of Roxo, by the way.
Cocaine doing clown.
Well, I'll introduce myself. My name's Tommy Blacha. I'm a co-creator of Metalocalypse, works at Titmouse. Thank God I found Titmouse on quite a few projects. So I guess, you know, this thing is a small studio in a big town, but, you know, I guess I just like to say that... It's no mystery to me why Titmouse is successful. And, you know, I guess I'm like a lot of people, never had any experience really with the big studios, but so I can speak of like Titmouse being a small studio, but how awesome the place is for Brendan and I when we came here to be able to do something all in one place, like under one roof. And we even like got thinking about like making, we went to the building the first time they were moving into the new building and put a studio in there, you know, we could do. Everything kind of came true that we thought, like, wouldn't it be great to, like, especially in animation when you have your animatic or your radio play and you're like, oh, fuck, why is that guy yelling? Well, let me just go into the booth and redo it quiet and email it over. And, oh, it's, you know, it's so much, like, problem solving is so easy. And so I just like to say, like, good work, you know. And now...
Oh, thanks, mister.
And now Titmouse is, of course, growing huge and it won't be like that anymore. You'll be mega successful and you'll just be like Walt Disney and... Frozen and weird.
Start shitting on everybody.
Molesting kids and stuff. But, Anyways, I'll have everyone introduce themselves. They're all titmouse aficionados, and we'll start here and go down. Introduce yourself, say a little bit something about yourself.
Well, you can't remember my name?
Yeah, Dave Henson.
I'm Dave Johnson.
What are you doing, titmouse?
I'm not currently working there, but...
Well, they might think you're the janitor or something.
Well, that's true. Cover artist of 100 Bullets.
See, he's doing a better job.
Comic artist. Has done designs for us.
G.I. Joe Resolute.
G.I. Joe Resolute.
Black Panther.
Black Panther. Slasher School.
Does anybody read comics here? Do you know who Dave Johnson is?
Yeah.
You better. You fucking what the fuck?
And
I'm Chris P. This was the studio that I kind of accidentally founded by having too much freelance work, and have been working in animation to some degree for the last 15 years or so. And and you said a lot of that stuff you saw is what we make.
He's the owner and founder of Titmouse, Chris.
Thanks for the clarification.
I'd like to say 9 o'clock is way too fucking early. For everyone on this panel, I don't know how you guys are here, but I'm John Schnepp. I directed Metalocalypse for the last 3 seasons.
All right. And hey, how ironic that would be something you hear in the halls of Titmouse often. Where's Schnepp?
Anyway, also worked on Venture Brothers, Black Panther, a bunch of other things. And how's it going?
Hello? Carl Jones, creator, executive producer of Freaknik the Musical, Black Dynamite animated series, and co-executive producer of the Boondocks.
I am Mike Roush, and I am, I'm an animator slash director thing.
Yeah. Animator director.
I was Titmouse's first employee.
Yeah. Yeehaw!
On my first day at Titmouse, I animated on a video and installed a toilet.
Hey, I'm Antonio Canobio. I'm the creative director for Titmouse, and I broke my elbow 2 days ago.
He was in a motorcycle accident.
It's my drawing hand, so for a while it's gonna be shitty, but here I am on Vicodin and everything's good.
Well, Antonio's a fabulous artist, who unfortunately his career is now over, so we'll probably not be spending much time on him. So, but going back to your Titmouse's first employee.
Yes.
Now, and you said
7 years.
7 years. You said something interesting, Chris. You didn't really look to form Titmouse. You just said you had too much freelance work, and it just kind of had a natural momentum.
Yeah, if you want to start a studio, I would suggest not... starting a studio. Don't, make a business plan and do the things that the books say. Because we tried to do that a couple years ago with last year with our video game division, and I realized I should have just done it accidentally, like we did with the cartoon-making part. Because basically I was just working at the studios at Cartoon Network, Nickelodeon, during the day, and since I came from New York, you just don't turn down freelance, unless it really, really sucks. So I would just hire people to work on the freelance, and then, two became four, became, 100 and some, and then it was like, oh, I guess this is now an animation studio.
It just grew. Yeah, I think the hardest thing about what always freaks me out about why, when I look at you in the business, like, oh my God, this is crazy, because people don't realize it's not like, oh, let's get a building, and here's a bunch of animators, and here's a staff, and now here's projects that come through, and then we funnel them that way, because it's like there's payrolls, and, it's especially with, as you're probably juggling so many potential shows, like, oh, we might have 5 shows coming up, and, anyone who knows how shows start, it's like, we need to know by Wednesday whether you'll have it. It's like, you wait for weeks, and so executives go on vacation, and they work like 2 hours a day. And so you're just always kind of waiting for them to pull the trigger on stuff. So, I'm sure they're in the position. It's like having a restaurant. It's like, how many people come through here? Sometimes 5, sometimes 3,000. Well, how many cooks do we fucking hire? Well, wait until there's 3,000, and you know, so talk a little bit about the problems of that, because I know, like, when you go to Titmouse, sometimes it's like, it's empty, there's like 7 people here, or it's like, we got to break this wall down and put in, you know, more animators in this closet on top of each other, so talk about some of those problems.
Yeah, that's definitely one of the challenges, and you know, certainly one of the challenges of this type of gig that has kind of evolved around me is I wanted to be, and still am to a certain degree, you know, a guy who draws pictures, not a businessman type. So all of the...
You look like a businessman.
Yeah, exactly. Any of the success we've had has been totally accidental from a business perspective. A lot of times we've been given advice by, you know, accountants and business people, like, you should not do this. This is a bad idea. Do not do this. You will not be successful. And we're like, well, yeah, it seems like we have to do this. And those are the things that have worked out the best.
Well, I'll tell you my perspective from just, you know, me having a show that started there is just, while you are like that, you know, ultimately when you're going to take your show somewhere, you have to have confidence that they know what they're doing. So even though his appearance and his hoodie and Budweiser hat, when it comes down to it, it is like, oh, that guy has fucking succinct problem-solving articulate skills, you know, so you do
I'm
have
not just articulate
yeah, articulate. No, but you'll find, like, when push comes to shove, Chris is like, well, I think we need to do this and this and that with the budget, and you're like, so you do have that, and that is essential, because it's not like a lot of people say, like, oh, this place is wild, let's just, you know, everything's so cool, let's, you know, when it comes down to it, you don't want to go with the place just for those reasons. You have to have your shit together, and it has to.
I'll say something real quick, is I think one of the successes of Titmouse is, and one of the reasons why I wanted to, like, work here and stay here, is the guy who owns the company can draw better than I can, which...
Not anymore.
You don't find that. Like, normally you go to a place and it's the suits who own the company, and you come here and Chris is the guy who owns the company, and he's sitting down at the drawing desk, and you sit next to him, and yeah, it's fun.
And the bigger thing is understands the problems of every step of the way. Anyone knows, you know every part of the business. So.
Yeah, and you can the projects go where they should go, not where the money should go, but where the project should go.
And some projects should go right in the toilet, and they do.
Yeah.
But if you could talk a little bit about your experience in other places versus Titmouse as far as big to small.
Yeah, I started under Bruce Timm and over at Warner Brothers, and then went over to Cartoon Network to work on Ben 10. So I've worked under big studio kind of suits and even creative people. But when I got over here, it was like totally different. And actually,
when you create artwork for our walls, it doesn't get stolen.
Well, that's true, yeah. But yeah, I kind of feel like he's got my back. Like, I remember being at Cartoon Network, and they tried to foster this attitude of, well, we're all big one happy family.
It's a lie.
Yeah, until you need that family to come to your aid, and then they're like, oh, see ya. You know, get the hell out.
Well, maybe they are like a family then.
Well, that's true, a dysfunctional family.
More like an actual family.
But how could I not want to work for a company that pranked me by hiring a little person dressed up as me to take over my seat? And enacted like I wasn't who I was, and I was already in the building. So, I mean,
that's pretty good,
Lil Dave.
That earned my loyalty for life, right there. So,
well, I know when my John I've known for many years, and when Brendan and I were starting Metalocalypse, John designed the characters, and what was great. I think sometimes you might get like resistance if you go to like a bigger place where, hey, this is my friend, he's awesome, he's going to do this, and like, you know, almost a lot of times you're immediately given obstacles because people are like, well, this is our studio, and, you know, they don't want you to have either too much power, I don't know what the deal is, but they were like so, like, welcoming the way, like, John fit in. Of course, John and Antonio had to have 2 fights, and then they were awesome together. I do remember that now.
Yeah, we fought.
Yeah, but even them fighting, or that was just, like, the greatest thing. It's like, because sometimes you see super talented people kind of like, they're not like, I use the corny word, they're not like nurtured, or, you know, they just fall by the wayside, and you see like dildos like go to the top, and you're like, wow, how did that happen? But you know, that's one thing about like Titmouse that was so great was like, you know, once it, you know, they met, you know, John, I know you guys knew each other, but it just like it all worked really good. It's, I mean, it's hard enough just to get put a show, you know, off the ground, period. And, you know, even with support, you know, so that was just something. So talk a little bit about that, your other experiences too, John.
excuse me. Hey, is there water available for us here? Anybody?
Prima Donna.
I just drank some really sugary.
Avion or something.
Really sugary coffee, so now my mouth is really dry.
Anyway, no. I started out working as an editor and did a bunch of different animation projects in the late 90s, and then moved out here and did a bunch of different jobs at like a whole bunch of different companies, and was working with Tommy on and off. We did like Orlando Jones show together, and he's always had my back in a lot of ways. And he early on was like, hey, we were working on something else, and he was like, hey, me and Brendan are doing this thing, you want to get involved? So designed the characters and did these little music videos for him. And back then it was like they were like went to South by Southwest, and they were still trying to get the show together. And Chris had just moved from his company that was really on Santa Monica, which is a little bit smaller, to this larger space. And they were like, hey, let's go check this new space out. And I met Chris like early on. I cut like a really early Motor City a trailer in 2000.
Yeah,
that's when I met him. I had like a little editing studio. And as you'll see now, Motor City is an awesome new thing. Basically, when I came to Titmouse, they gave me total freedom to do the show exactly how I saw it. Just like Brendan and Tommy, like they were like, I hadn't had that much experience directing cartoon shows. I mean, I'd done a whole bunch on my own and was hired in a smaller capacity, but I'd never done like X Sheets or any of this other kind of like super old school style stuff. I was all from the new school, so they were sort of like, yeah, let's. They wanted to do the Flash thing, which I was kind
of. Fuck X Sheets.
Yeah.
We were like, fuck it. We
fuck
don't need
X
them.
Sheets.
Animators are here. Talk to them.
Yeah. So it worked out so amazing, and it's been the best experience I've ever had working anywhere. And I've worked at a lot of studios, and also the same kind of like, you know, hey, it's all a big family. And I always remember like I used to have really long hair and wear like biker boots, and I went to Cartoon Network to edit the Space Ghost Coast to Coast, and they plopped me on this in this cubicle, and I was like in the lawyer area because they were like, we ran out of space for you where the other artists are, so why don't you sit here? And then the next day, the computer and the monitor were chained to the desk. And I fucking threw a fucking fit. I was like, hey, fuck you. I started yelling and like shaking the desk and chair. I was like, yeah, I'm gonna steal this, man. I can't wait to take this. And I just left. And then I went and yelled at all the people who hired me. And I was like, take those fucking chains off, bitch, or I'm leaving. And they took the chains off. But it was just literally one of those like the most annoying things that can ever happen to you. One of them. So.
And you did end up stealing that computer.
I did. I smashed it first. Totally broke it. Then I stole it. But
I think that's the lesson. While the big companies are afraid of mental illness, we nurture it and use it for, you know.
Embraced. Fully embraced.
But it's true. Even, you know, John, like just working on, you know, he's worn so many hats on our show, which is something I think also like that I don't think you could find at a bigger studio, like from, you know, designing characters to editing to fixing stuff to compositing on the fly. You know, it's like, and even you said that was a huge thing when we came over, where you said like, yeah, we all could like wear a lot of hats and just kind of do it. And usually like that's a really hollow statement from like a lot of people like in studios, because usually it's like, what are you doing in the editing room? You know, stuff like that. You've done now like your three projects there, right? You're coming on your third? Or?
Well, two, but yeah, two.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, two and some, maybe about 10 in my head that I'm going to pitch after this.
So could you just talk a little bit about your experience with like, obviously you're another person that's convinced by Titmouse and likes, you know, working there.
Tell
compared
projects.
To your other experiences.
Yeah, I was the first black employee at Titmouse. So, they let me use the same restroom. And it was cool, man. I mean, especially, you know, coming from the Boondocks where, you know, everything we did overseas, you know what I'm saying? So at a certain point, we begin to believe that you couldn't get cartoons made
in the United States that were at the same level of quality that we were looking for. And you know, coming to Titmouse, I found that that's 3,000% incorrect. You know what I'm saying? So, and that's not to say any other studios in America aren't good, but you know, I tell you, like, one of the challenges we had, like on the Boondocks, was, you know, being that we were kind of like a culture within a culture, you know, there was a lot of specific, you know, references that we had to send in order for them to understand the tone and the culture of the show that we were doing.
I know, I was not to cut you off, but I worked on Afro Samurai. It was like the most amazing thing, seeing that black culture thing go to Japan and come back. And
yeah,
what is going on?
Well,
it's difficult, you know.
Yeah, I mean, they would ask questions like, "How come Huey never smiles?" You know what I'm saying? And so we had to say he's Malcolm X. They go, "Oh, I get it." You know what I'm saying? Yeah. So, you know,
and you get a Malcolm X smiling coming. What are you doing? What's this?
Right. But I mean, you know, but it was a challenge. I mean, I had to literally act out everybody's, you know, I mean, I had to act out all the reference. So if I had to play a pimp, I had to play a black woman. Motherfucker, I know you ain't. You know what I'm saying? Like, they had to film me doing all this stuff and send it over there. Fortunately, it's not on YouTube yet. But like, I mean, from a pimp named Slickback to everything, man. So, you know, being at Titmouse, I never had to worry about that. Like, they actually nailed all of the acting. They nailed all of the performance. I mean, you know, the animation was just amazing. I mean, the talent they got over there is just ridiculous. I mean, that's from Freaknik, which is a real cartoony, you know, loose, very fun show, and then to like Black Dynamite animated series, which is a lot more, you know, more anime style, more realistic, and they like freak both styles like in a way that I haven't seen done before. I mean, to be honest with you, I'm actually more impressed with what we did on the Black Dynamite pilot than even what we did with the Boondocks animation-wise. Like, the production is incredible. The art direction is amazing. I mean, from scene to scene, I mean, everything is thought through. Like, how to tell a story, you know, from, you know, the backgrounds to, you know, the colors that are used, the tone, everything is taken into account. And I just, you know, just having that type of experience at a domestic studio is you know, I mean, it's worth more than gold. Like, you know what I'm saying?
And ultimately, it's kind of, it's usually less money, you know? And
yeah.
And just everything, that's a big thing, too. Everything under one roof is
right.
Kind of, like, impressive. But that's, you know, because it's just like another, like you said, it's not that animation overseas can be incredible and what have you, but it's just like another step of communication, another, like, here's another bunch of potential problems, you know? And it just cuts that out because that's, you know, it's all it is problem solving. So, what, you know, I have more, but... yeah, I'm like right. I just I'm right with you in my experience there too. Like, why that small studio and everything on one roof is just so awesome.
And I think the other thing is the communication. I mean, every department communicates. You know, whereas, you know, when you're doing stuff overseas, you know, not to harp on that, but that's just such a big thing for me. You know, it's like the I mean, from the writers to the storyboard artists to the animators to the background designers, everyone's in constant communication. So. You know, it's great, man. I mean, the most problems we had is probably like, you know, when we had to record when he came in and smoked so much that the alarm went off. Like you know, that's probably the biggest.
Well, do you remember?
Obstacle.
That was my favorite day.
Do you ever know that day blew my mind because someone took Chirp into your office, I believe, right?
And hit him.
A bunch of pot smoke, so it's like, oh, the fire department came, right? So they have to come in to check the alarm. And I swear to God, this is true. Sometimes I think I made it up, but it's true. They fucking took Chirp into your office, closed the door to be like, okay, he's isolated.
And like 11 guys of his entourage, like all jammed in there.
And fucking firemen came through there, and then firemen, like the captain was kind of like, you know, obviously, like smells like, why is the fire alarm off? Just smells like weed, all of Titmouse, right?
You want to say, nigga, you see Chirp standing there? You know what's what?
Chirp was like behind the wall, and then a fireman came by and was walking. And he goes, "Where's
Chirp?"
Like, that's, I don't know if he was making
not
a joke.
Not knowing that he's hidden behind
the door. And he was like, "I swear, I wanted to stop him and go like, dude, open the door. Like, he's right there. Like,
that's
I didn't
hilarious.
Know. So I was like, it was like, hey, was he making a joke? And like, you have no idea, sir.
That's funny. The fire department first looks for Chirp before they. Before
that's
they look for the actual fire.
Where's
Chirp?
Is there
Chirp
in here before I start checking the electrical?
That guy smokes so much pot that I got a contact high from my office.
which is like two doors away from the editing room. And this one guy, Juno, got so baked that he had to leave. He was like shaking, and he's like, I'm seeing elves. And he had to, a leprechaun, he had to leave.
Magic Wand was a leprechaun. He thought Don Magic Wand was a leprechaun.
Bishop?
Yeah, the bishop.
He's not a leprechaun?
And that's just, like, if that would have been at Warner Brothers, like, you know, the ventilation system, none of the employees could have got contact high. Right? Been too big. But so you two guys are similar in the sense that you're both, like, kind of, like, or, supremely talented guys. Well, you were, Antonio, before your arm.
Yeah, I was.
But and you obviously both had, just talk a little bit about how, like, why you've stayed at Titmouse. And or like Titmouse, as opposed to like pursuing going to Pixar or something where you could work 3 months on a gerbil's mohawk.
They pay better. Now, for me,
that's definitely not true.
Yeah, I've worked in major studios like Sony and Cartoon Network and stuff like that. Studios like that, and I don't like wearing one hat. I feel bored. I'm not asked to think. I'm asked to draw and. That's it in one style, so after you figure it out, it just gets boring. And at Titmouse, I work with amazing people that challenge me all the way through a production, and that's what I like. Yeah.
And Antonio conversely challenges us, where I think at a lot of studios, they'd say, this style is going to be way too difficult to execute. You are insane, sir. But... we indulge whatever ideas our artists, present to, pull them off, I think many of the times.
Yeah, lately I realized also we are trying to do something that's kind of cool. We are trying to bring back animation to America. I mean, on a small scale, not the big studio, like not the big movies. We are really trying to... on a TV series level, to bring it here, and the talent is gone because they all went to overseas, and we are bringing it back, and that's kind of cool. We'll see if we succeed, but we are trying really hard.
And, one of my jobs that I do, I was the lead animator of Metalocalypse and some other series that we have. And I gotta say, that's one of the super awesome things about a small studio is multiple times since I've been here, Chris has come to my desk and, you know, asked me a question. So, you know, Mike, do you know anything about After Effects? And I look him in the face and I'm like, you know, I gotta tell you the truth. No, I don't know anything. Well, here's an After Effects project. Can you have it to me by 3 o'clock? So, you know, that seems like a negative, but it's an absolute positive because... you know, I got out of college, and normally that's when a lot of people's education stops. And I've learned a ton more the first week at Titmouse than I did the whole 4 years of college that I went to Cal State Fullerton, represent. So, you know, in a smaller studio, you get the chance to do something. You get to try it out, and you get to show someone that you can do it. You don't have to do all those sneaky ways of, like, leaving post-its that... hey, I can draw, and you put it on the door somewhere, and someone has to ask, oh, who did that? You know, they actually come to you and say, hey, you want to have a crack at animating? I know you're not an animator, but you want to try because we're kind of low today. I think as a new person coming into a studio, you don't get those chances at other studios. You get, what are you? You're an animator, then you animate. What are you? You're a PA. Don't look at a drawing board, please. Go to your copy. Go make me some coffee, you know. So... That's a huge thing.
Yeah, and talk a little bit about your film, which is...
I guess I'm here also representing six of us now. Another thing at a small studio is Chris and Shannon opened it up to have some of the employees direct short films that we've been sending out to festivals around the world. I represent the first one that got done. My film is The Hidden Life of the Burrowing Owl. We also got, you saw clips of it, Pinched, Barco, and what is it, a Story of Two Trees? Yeah, Tale of Two Trees.
You can plug if you want. You can plug the L.A. Animation Festival.
Oh,
in 2 weeks we're going to have a panel where we're showing all the shows.
Yeah, in 2 weeks you can watch all of them.
That's why you won't see them today.
Yeah.
You got to go to that festival to see them.
Yeah, but, you know.
Nine in the morning.
It's been an excellent experience. I guess one of the reasons I started it is to kind of, you know, train directors and kind of, like, you know, do badass stuff that we own and that we could show people and kind of, like, advertise the studio. And my film has gone to over 40 festivals around the world, including Annecy, Anmamundi. It's played in Korea, Canada, England, France, Russia, Japan, all these places, and they funded it.
We try to keep the employees motivated too, you know, by doing stuff like that. There's also this thing we do called the 5 second day, where we stop all production and we ask people to, all the employees, to just do 5 seconds of animation minimum that day and just have fun with it. We don't give a theme, it's just all out, just do whatever you want, and we get great stuff out of it. And people are energized, I think, for weeks after, because they were asked to do something cool.
Yeah, it's important. It's super impressive. Like, even when Mike was making his film, I was almost like, you know, just being almost like having like a cynical thing inside. Like, why are they doing that? What, they think he's a really good animator and gonna make that film, and it's really, yeah. What's the angle? You know, there's kind of no angle other than, like, it'll, you know.
It's awesome. That's the angle.
Yeah, and all the momentum, even, like, it lives on. It goes to festivals. But even just, you know, like, all those things that, you know, bigger studios or whatever don't think about, like, just enhancing this guy's talent. And he's an employee. Makes you, you know. Then it goes through the days when there is the dark side of the small studio, which is, like, hey, Mike, can you not take a paycheck for 2 weeks? So I talk a little bit about that, not to, you know, because it is a reality of the small studio. Yeah. It sounds like everything's great, but
yeah, no, it's about time we started talking about the bad stuff. No, it is incredibly challenging, and one of the things, and especially, you know, it's as an artist, it's great. Probably one of the more challenging gigs at the studio is probably being a line producer or a production person, because if you're working for a studio that's funded by a distributor or a network, there's always a big old gigantic safety blanket in, you know, like a parachute waiting for you, whereas that's not always the case with us. So, you know, depending on our cash flow or things, you know, sometimes, like as Tommy said, sometimes things could go great and sometimes it gets a little scary. But we've just tried to go with our gut and, you know, so far made it out the other side. And every time we learn a lesson, it makes us stronger for the next one. You know, it's like at one point, one of the shows we were working on last year the executives had been fired, and they're like, well, we might shut the show down. We're going to send this kind of third party company in to come check out your books and, you know, make sure that.
Oh, that's fun.
Yeah, it's worth it. And I was like, what? This is, I don't know what this means. So, you know, I got together with Shannon, who's my wife, who runs the studio with me, and we're like, well, let's just be friendly to these folks and be totally transparent. And they came in and we actually made friends with them and ended up hiring one of them to actually then do our books. So our books are way better than if they were run by a couple of weirdo artists. So, you know, what seemed like a bad thing ended up becoming a good thing.
Did you ever think about, like, growing too fast, or, you know, do you ever, like, think about things like, you know?
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, last year we had...
I criticized it last
year. Yeah. Last year we had, like, a, you know, it, like, these kind of lessons that I was talking about with, kind of gradually starting a studio, I think, is a good way to do it, because you don't have a lot to risk all at once. When we started up our video game division, we came off of doing all these Guitar Hero games and... hooked up with some of the talent from that and started, like, kind of full-fledged with the whole staff, like a producer, an animator, a modeler, a programmer, an assistant programmer, a PA, and spent a lot of money real fast. And, you know, I was like, maybe next time we'll start with one guy. And, now we're if when we do the video game stuff, we do it with our existing talent or through freelance and stuff, and we'll have... taking a step back to then gradually grow that company a little bit.
I just want to go back to the line producers and say thank you to Shannon and Ben right here.
Ben Kalina.
Yeah, that organized the whole thing.
Right. And Petey sitting over there is one of our production
also.
People from our New York studio, which we just opened up recently. So the New York studio has been...
And
Petey, we used to work over at Venture Brothers, a place called World Leaders Entertainment. And I worked with him for like 6 months over on Venture Brothers. And that's a show that they ship overseas. So that was like, and they use the X sheets. So coming from Titmouse, where I was like, I'm so used to just like walk up to like say Mike and be like, hey, dude, like, can we like change this little thing here? And it's really easy to do. It was like, no, nothing can change. Everything's locked. It's very, once the script is written and recorded and edited, that's it. There's no, it's all gone for like 4 or 5 months. And I was gone, so I never got to, I was like, bye, going back to do Metalocalypse. So I was like, it was a different experience. But for me personally, like when I came to Titmouse, I was sort of like, what the fuck, Flash? I remember, it's like, no way can we do that. Because I was coming from like that thought of the 1999 dot bomb, like all those crazy ice box, yeah. Like beep, 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 really horrible Flash.
Yeah.
And I was like, God, that's impossible. It's going to look like crap. And Chris was like, no, I got this whole plan with the moving heads and all this other stuff. So. And it worked out great, and especially with someone like Mike pushing the boundaries of that program, it's like it's the one of the coolest tools I've ever seen used for animation.
Yeah, that's true. It's huge. That was a big thing when we were bringing the show here. It was kind of like Flash did have a bad reputation because, yeah, just like I think, you know, anyone can do it. Like, well, I can do it. Well, it must be fucking stupid. But you know, it's just like puppets being manipulated. But you said the smartest thing where you just said it's just a tool because a lot of people use it badly or that it's... It's so friendly for a lot of people to use that there's a lot of, like, you know, subpar looking stuff doesn't mean, you know, it's a bad tool.
Which leads us into another good thing about small studios is there's not a whole lot of rules. So Chris came to me and said, hey, we're going to make Metalocalypse. You want to figure out how to make this in Flash? So I started making, I didn't know you weren't supposed to do that. You know, there's rules that you don't know you're supposed to do, and then you do it, and then everyone else is like, ooh, how'd you do that?
Yeah.
You know, like, you know, there are rules that there shouldn't be a rule, you know? Like, yeah. The rules are meant to be broken. And
so do we get to five? Hi, son. So speaking of, just to go off of that Flash thing, you know, these systems we've been building to kind of like, you know, at first were due to, you know, incredibly small budgets and how are we going to pull this off and how are we going to make it funny. We've been able to apply to higher budget things like commercials and video game cutscenes and such. And, now we're doing this show for Disney XD that's a boys action show where we're doing all the animation in the States and we're using Flash, but we're not using it to make it cheaper per se. We're using it to make the animation better through the tricks that we've learned and apply it. And yeah, and John coined the term, you want to say it? Super Flash. So we've got a proprietary technique we call Super Flash, which is basically Flash with a different name in front of it.
It's just, yeah.
It's basically Flash with a good artist behind
it. Exactly. It's Flash. Like, I remember the moment, Flash. Too, when you actually had in our second episode where a character was riding a horse, and you did that, and it was just like, and that was like, I was just like, are you kidding me? That was like the best Flash. I was like, just so impressed.
Right on. So, and
I think
we're
going to
push this trailer on. So this is the show we're going to be doing for Disney XD. You'll see a teaser trailer for it. This will be on like fall of 2011, I think. And there's posters for it at the Disney booth and our booth.
Chris created it, by the way.
Yep. Oh, yeah, yeah. And and I should, if we're going to go out too, I should plug Metalocalypse. Season 3 on Blu-ray and DVD. Freaknik available on DVD, Blu-ray and DVD, right? And our first foray into print, our Titmouse comic, which we're calling the MOOC, the first edition's available at our booth, and I think at the Anime Books, or maybe, at least on there sometimes. Titmousestuff.com. Titmousestuff.com, yeah.
We need Ben Kalina, by the way.
Just Google the shit out of Titmouse.